Well, welcome. My job is to welcome you and to thank our co-sponsors along with the John Locke Initiative. We also thank the Gainesville Civic Media Center, the University of Florida History Program, the Department of History, and the UF Humanities Center. Before I introduce our moderator, who will then introduce our guest speaker, I'm here to tell you a little bit about the John Locke Initiative for the Study of Freedom, Law, and Western Heritage. First, I want to tell you who we are, and then a little bit about what our plans and our goals are. Our initiative is a cooperative effort among a dozen scholars throughout the University of Florida. We have representatives from the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences and the departments of History, Economics, Political Science, Linguistics, Languages, Literature, and Culture. We also have representatives from the Colleges of Law, Engineering, Agriculture, and the Bureau of Economic and Business Research, as well as the College of Business. Now, that's who we are. Let me tell you a little bit about what our plans are. We want to enhance the education of our students and their understanding of the great forces that helped in the formation of Western free institutions. We recognize, of course, the great diversity and the diversity of traditions at any university and the recognition that that's a common theme in academia. But we also believe that students have to be conversant with the great historical and intellectual traditions that gave rise to American founding. We are, after all, an American institution. Our nation's founders understood that self-government requires an educated and an informed citizenry. The university is wisely focusing now on globalization, and that's a very important goal. But it is also essential that our students become aware of their own responsibilities that accompany their citizenship. Our fear, and I hope that this is just a fear, but let me state that fear, are that many University of Florida students, just like many students throughout the United States, are unfamiliar with the Federalist Papers. That's one of the topics that I would like to teach about Tocqueville, Cicero, Montesquieu, and Locke himself, as well as the contribution of the Roman Republic and the Greek democracy to these free institutions that we enjoy in this country. With a large university such as we have some great luxuries. They give us a lot of freedom on the faculty to develop courses as we wish. And we have diverse faculty members from many colleges that can contribute to those courses. So we plan in the initiative to develop a curriculum across disciplines, which will focus on the rise of free institutions in the history of Western civilization. We foresee that cooperative effort, which has already begun, involving faculty so that we can offer students a variety of courses, such as in the American founding, the sources of American distinctiveness, the history of economic thought, the rise of the parliamentary system from the Middle Ages, and the Roman Republic's contribution to modern notions of the separation of powers. But courses such as that are not the only thing that we plan to do. We plan to continue a series of lectures and debates and brown bag discussions and reading groups. Opportunities such as this, which are somewhat formal, and many other opportunities which will be far more informal and smaller, closer knit, so that people can sit around and that they can talk. These events we plan and we hope for the participation of people from across the ideological perspective. All that we ask is that they have a civil tone and an atmosphere of mutual respect. And with that, I would like to introduce our moderator tonight, who is Doug Ray. He is the editor of the Gainesville Sun and a Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist. Thank you, Doug.
Thank you. Science, technology, engineering, math. What parent doesn't breathe a sigh of relief when their son or daughter comes home and says that they're going to major in one of these related fields, STEM fields? After all, the kid could have concentrated in English or religious studies, as I did, or history, something like that. Christiana Paxson, who's the president of Brown University, my alma mater, and the institution where our speaker today is on faculty, tackled that question head-on in a keynote speech earlier this week at the annual meeting of the National Humanities Alliance. As Paxson pointed out, the humanities certainly have their enemies. She named the usual suspects, talk radio show hosts, Republicans, and observed that good politics sometimes mean taking pot shots at the squishy thing called liberal arts. To quote, "If you happen to be governor of a larger southern state," she said, "then questioning the humanities or college in general can make for an easy and effective form of populist politics." I wonder who she was talking about. Humanities funding often strikes, she said, humanities funding often strikes critics as an especially muddle-headed form of government spending, which is not made more palatable by the fact that an education into the humanities so often turns out to be an education into liberalism. She's going on, "In the complex globalized world we are moving toward," she said, "it will obviously benefit American undergraduates to know something of the other civilizations, past and present, perhaps even our own history." Our speaker today is Gordon S. Wood. He's the Alvin O. Way University Professor and Professor of History Emeritus at Brown University. He received his BA degree from Tufts and his PhD from Harvard. He taught at Harvard University and the University of Michigan before joining the faculty at Brown in 1969. He's a prolific author. I won't read through all the books that he's written. I have a couple of them here, or the prizes he's won, except to say that he did win the Pulitzer Prize for his 1992 book, The Radicalism of the American Revolution. In 2011, he was awarded the National Humanities Medal by President Obama and the Churchill Bell Prize by Colonial Williamsburg. In 2011, he also received the Arthur M. Schlesinger Jr. Award from the Society of American Historians. In 2012, he received an award from the John Carter Brown Library and the John F. Kennedy Medal from the Massachusetts Historical Society. Professor Wood is a fellow of the American Academy of Science, Arts and Sciences and the American Philosophical Society. Wood also has become something of a cultural meme, a word that captures a cultural idea for approachable intellectualism. In the film Good Will Hunting, Matt Damon and Ben Affleck argue over his work. Wood breaks from interpretations of history that fall back on understandings from the past from within today's political frameworks. That's ticked off liberals and conservatives. Rather, Wood has gone back to original sources and helped us understand early American history with greater authenticity. So without further ado, I'll introduce Professor Wood.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Ray, and I'm delighted that you're all here on a rainy night. I'm grateful for such a large turnout. My talk is the revolutionary origins of the Civil War. Now, when Abraham Lincoln, President Lincoln, when he was elected president in 1860 on a platform of preventing the extension of slavery into the West, the Southern states felt that their way of life was threatened, and they seceded from the Union. You all know that. Now, since many states, including those of New England, had talked of secession through the whole antebellum period, explaining the secession of the Southern states is not a major historical problem. We can fairly easily account for why the Southern states seceded. What is more difficult to explain is why the Northern states cared. Why was the North willing to go to war to preserve the Union? It was not because the North was bent on the abolition of slavery, at least not at first. Many Northerners, of course, were opposed to slavery, but what they were especially opposed to was the extension of slavery into the West. Northerners were opposed to the extension of slavery into the West because they knew that slavery would create a society incompatible with the one they wanted for their children and grandchildren, who they presumed would settle in the West. But this was not the only reason why the North cared enough for the Union to engage in a long and bloody war that cost Northerners several hundred thousand lives. to fully understand why the North cared enough to resist the secession of the Southern states, we have to go back to the Revolution, the American Revolution, and the ideas and ideals that came out of it. Lincoln's words, which have been aptly called his sword, were crucial in sustaining the struggle to maintain the Union. With his words, he reached back to the Revolution to draw inspiration and understanding of what the Civil War meant for the nation and the world. He knew what the Revolution was about and what it implied, not just for Americans, but for all humanity. The United States was a new Republican nation in a world of monarchies, a grand experiment in self-government, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. The American people of 1860, said Lincoln, deeply felt the moral principle of equality expressed in the Declaration of Independence. And this moral principle made them one with the founders. In Lincoln's extraordinary words, as though they were blood of the blood and flesh of the flesh of the men who wrote the Declaration. Now, this emphasis on liberty, equality, he said, was the electric cord. That was his metaphor, the electric cord that links the hearts of patriotic and liberty-loving men together, that will link those patriotic hearts as long as the love of freedom exists in the minds of men throughout the world. Now, with words like these, drawing on the meaning of the American Revolution, Lincoln expressed what many Americans felt about themselves and the future of all mankind. Liberty and equality, he said, were promised not just to the people of this country, but to the world for all future time. The Revolution, he said, gave promise that in due time, the weight should be lifted from the shoulders of all men, and that all should have an equal chance in the race of life. But if the American experiment in self-government failed, then this hope for the future would be lost. Spreading freedom and democracy around the world had been an explicit goal of the Revolution. It was what turned the little colonial rebellion that the Americans engaged in into a world historical event, important for everyone throughout the world. Americans believe that the French Revolution of a decade or so later, 1789, was a direct consequence of their revolution. And Lafayette thought so too. That's why he sent the key to the Bastille, the symbol of the Ancien Régime, the prison, key to the Bastille to Washington. And it remains today hanging in Mount Vernon. But all the 19th century efforts in creating democracy in Europe had ended in failure, including the French. By the time Lincoln was speaking, Napoleon III, the Emperor Napoleon III, was on the throne of France. Americans had seen that French Revolution spiral back into monarchy and tyranny. And attempts by the Europeans to create democracies in the revolutions of 1848 had all been crushed. By the 1860s, as Lincoln pointed out, the United States was, indeed, a lone beacon of democratic freedom in a world of monarchies. On American shoulders alone rested the survival of the possibility of self-government. It was indeed the last best hope for the future of democracy. That responsibility was what sustained Lincoln throughout the war. A war, as he said in his Gettysburg Address, the 150th anniversary of which we're celebrating this year, a war was attesting whether this nation, dedicated to liberty, equality, and self-government, could long endure. In commemorating the Civil War, which we're doing over the course of the next few years, we commemorate the Revolution. Indeed, in an important sense, Northern success in the Civil War was the culmination of the Revolution. Now, how did this nation that had once been united enough to defeat the greatest power in the world, Great Britain, fall apart and engage in a long and bloody Civil War? I suppose the seeds of the Civil War were sown when the first slaves were brought to Virginia in the 17th century. But no one, of course, sensed that at the time. Even in 1776, when Americans declared their independence from Great Britain, no one foresaw a civil war in this newly created United States. To be sure, the 13 separate North American colonies were not very united. That they were able to come together at all in 1776 was something of a miracle. Before the Revolution, the British colonists had little sense of the connectedness with one another. Most of them had closer ties with London and Britain than they had with one another. Until the Continental Congress met in Philadelphia in 1774, more of its members had been to London than had been to Philadelphia. It was Great Britain and its policies that created the colonists' sense of being Americans. In fact, the British officials were the ones who first defined the term Americans. The Americans called themselves Englishmen. It's the London officials who talked about these faraway Americans. And until the last moment before independence, the colonists thought of themselves, as I say, as Englishmen. It was British tyranny expressed in the Coercive Acts of 1774 that made the colonists, like Patrick Henry, declare that they were not Virginians or New Yorkers, but Americans. The long and bloody war with Great Britain, in which all parts of the country suffered at one time or another, was a searing experience. More Americans died in that war in proportion to population than in any other war in our history, with the exception, of course, of the Civil War, where both sides were Americans. No wonder, then, that the Revolution bred an overwhelming sense of unity. The glorious cause of the war united all Americans. The Revolution and the beliefs and ideals that came out of it, liberty, equality, self-government, created national bonds that were not easily broken. Indeed, they are the bonds, I think, that still hold us together and make us think of ourselves as a single people. It's the belief in these ideas and ideals. We're not, there is no American ethnicity. All we have are these ideas that unite us. Now, of course, Americans at the time of the Revolution were aware of sectional differences, differences that were essentially based on slavery. They knew that. Although slavery in 1776 legally existed in all of the new Republican states, 90% of the nearly 500,000 African American slaves, constituting about a fifth of the population of the entire country, lived in the South. 90% lived in the South, working in the tobacco fields of the Chesapeake or in the rice swamps of Georgia and South Carolina. Now, these southern states were obviously different from those in the North. In 1776, John Adams worried that the South was too aristocratic, he said, for the kind of popular Republican government he advocated in his pamphlet, Thoughts on Government, which was a model where it gave advice to everyone how to draw up your own state constitution. But he was surprised, Adams was surprised to learn that the southern states more or less did adopt the kind of popular mixed government that he suggested, that is bicameral legislatures, separate judiciary. And he expressed relief in seeing the pride of the haughty, as he said, brought down a little by the Revolution. Of course, what Adams was referring to was a slaveholding society dominated by planter aristocrats, those of the haughty, that contrasted in his mind, and I think in reality, with the more egalitarian small farm societies of the North, especially in the states of New England. But slavery was not inconsequential in the North. Black slaves made up nearly 7% of the population of New Jersey and 14% of the population of New York City. Nearly 12% of my own state, Rhode Island, was composed of slaves. It was not just the Southern revolutionary leaders, you know, Washington, Jefferson, Madison, and so on, who owned slaves. So did many of the Northern leaders. John Hancock, Boston's John Hancock, New York's Robert Livingston, and Philadelphia's John Dickinson were all slaveholders. On the eve of the Revolution, the mayor of Philadelphia possessed 31 slaves. Nonetheless, the sectional differences were obvious. In the mid-1780s, the Boston merchant Stephen Higginson was convinced in their habits, manners, and commercial interests, the southern and northern states are not only very dissimilar, he said, but in many instances directly opposed. Jefferson tended to agree. And in 1785, he outlined to a French friend who had asked him what's the difference between North and South, he outlined the differences as he saw them, which he attributed mostly to climate, differences of climate, not slavery. The Northerners, he wrote, were cool, sober, laborious, persevering, independent, jealous of their own liberties and just to those of others, interested, chicaning, superstitious, and hypocritical in their religion. By contrast, he said, The Southerners were fiery, voluptuary, indolent, unsteady, independent, zealous for their own liberties, but trampling on those of others, generous, candid, and without attachment or pretensions to any religion, but of the heart. Now, despite his sensitivity to the differences, however, Jefferson and most other Southern planters did not, as yet, see these sectional differences as endangering national unity. Now, since we know how the story turned out, it's easy to read back signs of what we know will happen. But it's a mistake, of course, to see too many anticipations of the Civil War in these early revolutionary decades. In the 1780s, leaders from both the North and the South came to realize that the Confederation, the Articles of Confederation, the League of States that we created, sort of like the EU, created in 1777, not ratified until 1781, just 6 months before Yorktown, and they became convinced by the 80s that it wasn't working out and would have to be reformed or scrapped altogether. The slaveholding state of Virginia took the lead in the reform and was supported by national-minded leaders from the northern states. The differences that arose in the Constitutional Convention that drew up the Constitution and later in the differences that arose later in the 1790s were differences of ideology, not sectional differences between North and South. The delegates differed essentially over the strength of the national government vis-a-vis the states. This was the big argument that took place in Philadelphia, 1787, that summer. The split in the Constitutional Convention was essentially between the large states, Virginia, Pennsylvania, Massachusetts, that wanted proportional representation in both houses of Congress, and the small states that feared being overwhelmed by the more populous states, small states, Connecticut, Rhode Island, of course, wasn't even there, Connecticut, Delaware, and so on. James Madison of Virginia and James Wilson of Pennsylvania eventually had to surrender to the wishes of the small states and accept the so-called Connecticut Compromise. You're all familiar with that. That gave equal representation of two senators from each state, which has come into the four recent publications. It's so undemocratic in small d that it seems appalling, but that was the compromise. The issue, in other words, did not divide along sectional lines. Madison and Wilson were on the same side. Although at one point, and this has been picked up by historians, but I think falsely, Madison tried to suggest that the real division in the convention, he said, was between the slaveholding and the non-slaveholding states. But everyone knew that this was a tactical feint designed by Madison to get the convention off of the large state, small state division that was undermining his desperate, and I mean desperate, desire for proportional representation in both houses. When that Connecticut Compromise occurred, he didn't think it was a compromise. He thought it was a failure. And he and his Virginia delegates and several others from Pennsylvania caucused, should we walk out? They didn't, but they did not see that as a compromise. That was a major defeat as far as Madison was concerned. He didn't want any state representation because originally the senators, of course, were elected by the state legislatures. He thought that any representation of the state legislatures would vitiate the national government. It simply would destroy it because state loyalties were so strong. You have to keep that in mind. People thought of their country as Virginia. My country is Virginia or Massachusetts and so on. It's like the EU today. How do you develop loyalty to this thing called Europe? So the party division that arose in the 90s was not between North and South. The differences between the Federalists and the Jeffersonian Republicans was over the nature of the national government and over the support or opposition to the French Revolution. Although the leadership and base of the Republican Party was located in the South, the party was not and could not be exclusively a sectional party. The Northern Republicans were a very important and increasingly dynamic part of the Jeffersonian Republican Party. Jefferson rightly never saw himself as a leader of a sectional party. He was, as he said, the leader of the world's best hope. He's the first person to use that phrase. A popular democratic Republican government that was something new under the sun, again, his phrase, and that promised eventually to ameliorate the condition of men over a great portion of the globe. Now, it's no wonder that Lincoln looked back to Jefferson, all honor to Mr. Jefferson, because his vision, Lincoln's vision, was Jefferson's vision. Still, there was the serpent of slavery lurking in this Arcadian garden of yeoman farmers that threatened to destroy the democratic republican dream. At the outset, the revolutionary leaders were well aware of this serpent. They knew from the beginning that slavery was incompatible, inconsistent with the ideals of the revolution. Indeed, it was the revolution that made slavery a problem for Americans. Before the mid-18th century, most Americans, like most people throughout the world, for thousands of years, largely took slavery for granted as the lowest and most degraded status in a hierarchical world of degrees of unfreedom and dependency. Nobody from the Greeks on thought slavery was a problem until the middle of the 18th century. And, of course, few colonists had ever criticized it. Historians go back and find a Quaker here in 1700 who was criticizing it, but that's a mistake to somehow assume that that was represented common opinion. But, of course, the revolution changed everything. All the revolutionary leaders realized that there was something painfully inconsistent between their talk of freedom for themselves and the owning of black slaves. If all men were created equal, as all enlightened persons were now saying, Jefferson's phrase is not novel or original with him, then what justification could there be for holding Africans in slavery? Since the American colonists are by the law of nature born free, indeed all men are, white or black, does it follow, asked James Otis of Massachusetts in 1764, does it follow 'tis right to enslave a man because he is black? The revolutionary rhetoric made the contradiction excruciating for many Americans, both in the North and the South. Northerners, like Samuel Cook in his Massachusetts election sermon of 1770, confessed that in tolerating black slavery, we, the patrons of liberty, have dishonored the Christian name and degraded human nature nearly to the level of the beasts. Prominent slaveholding Southerners, like Jefferson, agreed and declared that the abolition of domestic slavery is the great object of desire in these colonies where it was unhappily introduced in their infant state. They always blamed Great Britain, England, for causing slavery in America. Now, given the mounting sense of inconsistency between the revolutionary ideals and the holding of people in bondage, it is not surprising that the first anti-slave convention in the history of the world was held in Philadelphia in 1775. The two came together. If the revolutionary leaders, these founders, who were otherwise so enlightened, so far-sighted, knew that slavery contradicted everything in that the revolution was about, why didn't they do more to end the institution that they claimed to abhor? As you can well imagine, this is the question that historians wrestle with right now, and it's the question that every student asks of these founding fathers. The reason I think they didn't act more forcefully was that many of them, perhaps most of them, thought that time was on the side of abolition. As incredible as it may seem to us, who know what they could not know, that is, their future, the leaders tended to believe that slavery was on its last legs and was headed for eventual destruction. Dr. Benjamin Rush was convinced that the desire to abolish the institution prevails in our councils and among all ranks in every province, with hostility towards slavery mounting everywhere among the enlightened in the Atlantic world. Rush in 1774 predicted that there will not be a Negro slave in North America in 40 years. Enlightened Virginians also assumed that slavery could not long endure. Jefferson told a French correspondent in 1786 that there were in the Virginia legislature men of virtue and talent enough to propose and to move toward the gradual emancipation of slaves. To be sure, they saw that the moment of emancipation was not yet arrived, he said, but with the spread of light and liberality among the slaveholders, that moment was coming. Slavery could simply not stand against the relentless march of liberty and progress. That the Philadelphia Convention in 1787, that the convention was scrupulous in not mentioning slaves, slavery, or Negroes in the final draft of the Constitution seemed to point to a future. They could anticipate a future without the shameful institution. If the revolutionary dream that slavery would naturally die away had been realized, of course, there would never have been a civil war. This illusion that slavery would die a natural death led the revolutionary leaders to table efforts to abolish the institution. They thought in time that it would simply disappear. But, as we know, slavery in the United States was not on its last legs at all. Predictions of its demise could not have been more wrong. Far from being doomed, American slavery, in fact, was on the verge of its greatest expansion. Now, how could the revolutionary leaders have been so mistaken? How could they have deceived themselves so completely? For a full generation, the nation's leaders lived with the illusion that the institution of slavery was declining and on its way to being eliminated. Of all the illusions they had about the future, this surely was the greatest. But the founders' self-deception and mistaken optimism were understandable, for they wanted to believe the best. And initially, there was evidence that slavery was in fact being eliminated and dying out. The northern states, where slavery was not deeply rooted in the economy, began immediately to attack the institution, and by 1804, every northern state had provided for the eventual end of slavery. The South, where slavery was much more deeply entrenched in the economy and the society, was slower to act. But even in the South, there were encouraging signs of movement against the institution, especially in Virginia. Now, Virginia was no ordinary state. It was by far the most populous state. Indeed, by itself, it made up a fifth of the population of the entire nation. It was as well the largest state in territory and the richest state of all the 13. Therefore, it's not surprising that four out of the first five presidents were Virginians. And the working model for the Constitutional Convention in 1787 was the Virginia Plan. During the first few decades of the new republic, Virginia dominated the nation as no state in our history ever has. As Virginia went, so went the nation. There were signs in the 1770s and 80s that Virginia was trying to do something about slavery. If Virginia could abolish slavery, it was assumed then the rest of the South would surely follow. In Virginia, the harsh black codes of the early 18th century had fallen into neglect. And by the time of the Revolution, fraternization between whites and black slaves had become much more common, both in sporting events, horse races, and so on, and in religion. We even have examples of white congregations being preached to by a black slave evangelical preacher. The growing of wheat in the Upper South, instead of tobacco, was changing the nature of slavery in the Upper South, and many of the planters, now calling themselves farmers, they're not planters any longer, began hiring out their slaves, suggesting that to some that slavery might well be replaced by wage labor. Other evidence from the Upper South seemed to reinforce the idea that slavery was on its way to extinction. What could be a more conspicuous endorsement of the anti-slave cause than having the College of William and Mary, Williamsburg, Virginia, in 1791 confer an honorary degree on the celebrated British abolitionist Granville Sharp? Think about that. What were these planters thinking in giving an honorary degree to this British abolitionist? I think that's the kind of fact that should stir the minds of any historically minded student. How come? Why? That there were more anti-slave societies created in the South than in the North was bound to make people feel that the South was moving in the same direction of gradual emancipation as the North. In Virginia and Maryland, some of these anti-slave societies brought freedom suits in the state courts that led to some piecemeal emancipation. These suits may not seem very meaningful to us by our standards, but by the standards of the 18th century, they were significant. If the slaves could demonstrate that they had a maternal Indian or white ancestor, they could be freed. The whole line could be freed. And hearsay evidence was often enough to convince the courts. You know, folk tradition. This is what the family tradition is. Whole families, recalled one sympathetic observer, were often liberated by a single verdict, the fate of one relative deciding the fate of many. By 1796, nearly 30 freedom suits were pending at Virginia courts. By the 1790s, the free black population in the Upper South had increased to over 30,000. By 1810, the free blacks in the area numbered over 94,000. When even Southerners like Jefferson, Patrick Henry, Henry Lawrence, and St. George Tucker publicly deplored the injustice of slavery, from that moment, declared the New York physician and abolitionist E.H. Smith in 1798, from that moment, the slow but certain death wound was inflicted upon it. That's how they thought. Everywhere, even in South Carolina, slaveholders began to feel defensive about slavery, began to sense a public pressure against the institution they had never felt before. In the aftermath of the revolution, whites in Charleston expressed squeamishness now about the evils of slavery, especially the public trading and punishment of slaves. In the 1780s, some of the Carolinian masters expressed a growing reluctance to break up families and even began manumitting some of their slaves, freeing more slaves in that decade of the 1780s, than had been freed in the previous three decades. Now, what helped to convince many people in the North that slavery's days were numbered was the promised ending of the despicable slave trade in 1808, promised in the Constitution. Almost everywhere in the New World, slavery was dependent on the continued importation of slaves from Africa. Everywhere in South America, the Caribbean, and presumably in South Carolina and Georgia. Although this need for slaves from Africa was no longer true of the Upper South, South Carolina and Georgia were still, as I say, were importing slaves. The fact that the Deep South and the rest of the New World, and I mean the Caribbean and South America, needed slave importations to maintain the institution, I think deluded many Americans into believing that slavery in America, North America, was also dependent on the international slave trade, and that ending that slave trade, that international slave trade, would eventually end slavery itself. Those who held out this hope, of course, were utterly wrong. Couldn't have been more wrong. They simply did not appreciate the demographically different world of North American slavery and how different it was from the rest of the Southern Hemisphere of the Caribbean and South America. They were blind to the fact that in most states of North America, the slaves were approximating the growth of the whites, nearly doubling in number every 20 to 25 years, which, by the way, is doubling the rate of growth of European populations. We had a fertility rate of 7, which means the average woman had seven children. And this was doubling our population. And it turns out the slaves were demographically growing as rapidly as the whites. Northerners had little or no appreciation that slavery in the South was a healthy, vigorous, and expansive institution. As far as they were concerned, the Virginia and Maryland planters, who had more slaves, of course, than they knew what to do with, were enthusiastically supporting an end to the international slave trade as the first step in eliminating the institution of slavery itself. That was, of course, not their main motive. They had more slaves. They did not need more slaves, and they were selling slaves to the Deep South, to the new territories of Mississippi and Alabama. This assault on the overseas slave trade appeared to align the Chesapeake planters with the anti-slave forces in the North and confused many Northerners about the real intentions of the Upper South, which, in fact, was in the business, as I say, of exporting its surplus of slaves. Virginia, through the whole antebellum period, tobacco was gone. They couldn't grow cotton in Virginia. The climate's not up to it. Their basic crop, if you will, product, was slaves through the whole antebellum period. All these developments misled many Americans and allowed them to postpone dealing with the issue. Like John Adams and Oliver Ellsworth, the third Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, they thought that when the importation of slaves was cut off, white laborers would become so numerous that the need for slaves would disappear. Slavery, said Ellsworth, in time will not be a speck in our country. Now, in the meantime, the initial differences between the two sections were rapidly and dramatically increasing, become much more severe. During the three or four decades following the Revolution, the North and South grew much further apart. Both sections were American and Republican. Both professed a similar rhetoric of liberty, popular government. But beneath the surface, they were fast becoming very different places, with different cultures and values, one coming to honor common labor as the supreme human activity, the other continuing to think of labor, manual labor, in traditional terms going back to the ancient Greeks, as mean, despicable, and fit only for slaves. When on the eve of the Civil War, the South complained that it had remained true to the 18th century Republic and that it was the North that had changed, it was entirely correct. In the years immediately following the Revolution, the North was radically transformed politically, economically, socially, and culturally. It was not that the population growth in the two sections was all that different, although by 1810, New York had outstripped Virginia as the most populous state. It was the varied nature of the growth in the North. The northern states were building turnpikes, canals, creating banks and corporations, greasing the growing internal domestic trade with paper money to an extent not duplicated in the southern states. Everywhere in the northern states, farm families were busy buying and selling with each other. The society was still predominantly rural and agricultural and remained so through a good part of the 19th century, with no large manufacturing cities, as in England. But in many northern towns, people seemed to be doing everything but farming. Take this little town of Mount Pleasant, Ohio, 1815. Population of only 500 people. This little town still exists as a kind of suburb of Steubenville in Ohio. It had several dozen artisans and manufacturing shops, including 3 saddlers, 3 hatters, 4 blacksmiths, 4 weavers, 6 shoemakers, 3 cabinet makers, 1 baker, 1 apothecary, 2 wagon makers, 2 tanneries, 1 wool carding machine maker, 2 wool carding machinists, 1 wool spinning machinist, 1 flax spinner, 1 nail factory. Within a 6-mile radius of this little town, 500 people, were 9 merchant mills, 2 grist mills, 12 sawmills, 1 paper mill, 1 woolen factory, and 2 fulling mills. Now, there's nothing like this in the South. Nothing like this little Ohio town. There were so many towns being created in Ohio in this period that they ran out of names. There's so many little towns. Nothing like this. When Tocqueville stood on the borders of the Ohio River and looked across to Kentucky, he saw a very different world, a slave-ridden world that created a very different culture. The North, particularly in places like Ohio, was becoming the most highly commercialized society in the world. I think more commercialized than any other place, even England. More people buying and selling with each other. It was becoming increasingly dominated by hosts of middling people: commercial farmers, mechanics, clerks, teachers, businessmen, and industrious, self-trained, would-be professionals who celebrated work and the making of money to a degree unprecedented in the history of the world. This celebration of labor, especially manual labor, was important. As I say, ever since Aristotle, leisured aristocrats and the professional classes held labor, especially manual labor, and the making of money in contempt. Even someone who ran a business, say a printing business with 20 employees, was nonetheless considered to be involved with manual labor and thus contemptible. This is why Benjamin Franklin had to retire at the age of 42 and become a gentleman. He could not be a gentleman as long as he's engaged in business. Those who worked for a living, particularly working with your hands, and of course printers, even if he's the employer, he's got employees who work with their hands. Men who worked for a living, Aristotle had said, could never possess virtue and could never exercise political leadership. Now, perhaps nothing separated the North and South more than their contrasting views of labor. The South, dominated as it was by leisured and slaveholding planters, could scarcely conceive of labor as anything but despicable, as shameful. Slavery, as it had for centuries, going all the way back to the ancient Greeks, requires a culture that holds labor in contempt. So scorn for work and the holding of slaves were two sides of the same coin. That's crucial, I think, in the separation of these two sections. The North, of course, went off in a different direction. In several decades following the Revolution, these middling men of the North, using the egalitarian rhetoric that came out of the Revolution, anti-aristocratic rhetoric of the Revolution, launched a wholesale campaign against aristocrats. That's the term they used. We would use elites, I suppose. Aristocrats who had scorned them for ages. They urged each other to shed their earlier political apathy and accused all these gentlemen who, as one critic said, were not under the necessity of getting their bread by industry, of being parasites and of living off the labor of the honest farmers and mechanics, mechanics being artisans and people who were businessmen, essentially, proto-businessmen. Those leisured aristocrats who do not labor but who enjoy in luxury the fruits of labor, these critics said, had no right to decide the laws as they had in the past. Now, of course, the American aristocrats these middling people attacked in their own midst in the North were not European aristocrats. In the eyes of these middling sorts, these leisured aristocrats, what we today might label elites, mostly members of the professions, lawyers, judges, physicians, clergymen, government officials, and so on. Anyone who is not involved with manual labor in one form or another, or running a business. In the eyes of these middling sorts, these artisans, these clerks, these businessmen, these elites seem to be doing no real work. Now, this celebration of labor inevitably made the South, with its leisured aristocracy supported by slavery, seem increasingly anomalous. In reaction, of course, the Southern aristocrats began emphasizing their cavalier status in contrast to the money-grubbing Northern Yankees. They began claiming that they were the only true gentlemen left in a money-grubbing America. Now, it was not just the brutal fact of slavery that mattered. It was what slavery did to the society. Slavery in the South tended to create a different economy, politics, and culture from the North. While the North was coming to value labor as necessary and fit for all social ranks, much of the white population of the South was becoming more and more contemptuous of work and more desirous of acquiring the leisure that slavery seemed to afford. Indeed, so great was the white cult of indolence that some Southerners began to worry about the discrepancy between an industrious North and a lethargic South. "Where there is Negro slavery," one concerned Virginian told Madison, "where there is Negro slavery, there will be laziness, carelessness, and wastefulness. Not as much among the slaves as among the white masters," he said. This Virginian even claimed that our intelligent Negroes are far superior in mind, morals, and manners than those who are placed in authority over them. Now, the South grew in population and prospered, but its culture and society remained traditional in many ways. During the antebellum decades, when the North was commercially exploding, the South remained essentially what it had been in the 18th century, a staple-producing, slave-holding society. Cotton replaced tobacco and rice as the principal staple, but the society, the economy, and much of the politics remained roughly what they had been back in the middle of the 18th century. Slavery determined the organization of the society. Now, when I was in graduate school in the early 60s, I read a book on Southern politics that had been written by the Harvard political scientist V.O. Key. And I was at the same time studying colonial history. Key's book dealt with the 1930s, Southern politics in the 1930s. And what he described, that political world, that oligarchic county court world, seemed very similar to what I was learning about colonial society in the South, in Virginia, in the 18th century. With the state legislatures very much in control of the government and county oligarchs sort of replicating themselves at the local level. There was no slavery left by the 1930s in the South, but politically the Southern states had not changed much since the 18th century. They still believed in minimal government, in low taxation, and allowing the county court oligarchs to run the show. In the antebellum South, not only did the wealthy slaveholding planters manage the overseas marketing of a staple crop of cotton, and that, of course, helped them dominate their neighborhoods because they were the funnel through which the sale, if you're a small farmer growing cotton, you had to go to the big guy on your neighbor to sell that cotton. And it created and reinforced the unequal relationship of patrons and clients. And also, and ultimately, I suppose, and more important, their patriarchal system of slavery sustained a hierarchical world, a world that was very different from that of the northern states. The commercial institutions that, as I mentioned, that were springing up in the North had few counterparts in the southern states. The South did not have the numbers of turnpikes or canals or banks or corporations and the issuing of paper money to the extent that the North did. Fearing any interference with their peculiar institution, the planter-dominated legislatures kept government to a minimum. They taxed their citizens much less heavily and spent much less on education and social services than the legislatures of the North. Although most Southern farmers were not slaveholders and many of the plain folk of the South may have worked as hard as any ambitious Northern artisan, these ordinary Southern folk could never give the same kind of enterprising, middling tone to the society they lived in, that would have been comparable to that existed in the South. There were fewer middling institutions in the South, fewer towns, fewer schools, fewer newspapers, fewer businesses, fewer manufacturing firms, and fewer shops. There were fewer middling people in the South, fewer teachers, fewer clerks, publishers, editors, engineers, inventors, patents, all of these, much less than you had in the North. The antebellum South never became a middling, commercially minded society like that of the North. Its patrician order of large slaveholders continued to dominate both the culture and the politics of the section. As James Madison privately admitted in the 1790s, in proportion as slavery prevails in a state, the government, however democratic in name, must be aristocratic in fact. Now, as the North and South gradually grew apart, each section began expressing increasing frustration with the other, aggravating differences that, of course, had been present from the beginning of the Revolution. Northerners, especially New England Federalists, began to complain about what they saw as the unjustified Southern dominance of the federal government. They focused on the three-fifths clause of the Constitution that counted slaves as three-fifths of a person for assessing representation in the House of Representatives and in the Electoral College. The Federalists charged that the three-fifths clause gave an unfair advantage to the Republicans and was responsible for Jefferson's election in 1800. And thus was born the idea of a slave power that was unfairly usurping control of the national government from the free states, something that Lincoln devoutly believed in. Now, even more unsettling to some Northerners was the gradual realization that slavery was not dying in the South after all. The earlier enthusiasm of the Upper South to liberalize its slave system began to dissipate, especially following news of the slave rebellion in the French colony of Saint-Domingue, which became that was in 1791, and by 1804 you had the creation of Haiti. Gabriel's conspiracy in Virginia in 1800 further destroyed the hopes of many that Virginia was gradually eliminating slavery. The earlier leniency in judging freedom suits in Virginia stopped, ended, and manumissions in the state rapidly declined. Southerners now began reversing their earlier examples of racial mingling. Evangelical Protestant churches ended their practice of mixed congregations. After 1800, the Southern states began enacting a whole new set of black codes that resembled the later Jim Crow laws, tightening up the institution of slavery and restricting the behavior of free blacks. Indeed, because free blacks mingling in the society posed a threat to slavery, they ordered them to leave the Southern states. The final blow to all the illusions the founders had lived with came, of course, with the Missouri crisis in 1819. The attempt by a New York congressman, James Talmadge, and the House of Representatives to attach a prohibition of slavery to the bill admitting Missouri to the Union precipitated a sectional crisis more severe than anything that had ever been felt before. Jefferson told John Adams that from the Battle of Bunker's Hill to the Treaty of Paris, we never had so ominous a question. I thank God that I shall not live to witness its issue. The Missouri crisis caused the scales to fall from the eyes of both Northerners and Southerners. The North came to realize clearly now that the South was not going to abolish slavery after all, that it was aiming to carry the institution into the West. That's what Missouri was about. The South, for its part, came to realize more clearly than ever before that the North really cared about abolishing slavery and would never stop trying to end it, and certainly did not want the institution to spread to the West. From that moment, Americans clearly saw signs of a storm on the horizon, at first no bigger than a man's hand, but signs of a storm that would grow larger and more ominous every year. From that moment, I believe the Civil War was inevitable. Thank you. Thank you very much. Those of you who want some food can go over there to over this side, but we can start with questions that you might have. I'll be happy to answer any queries you have. I'm sure you have questions. Yes, sir.
In terms of populations, what was the population of the plantation owners in the South?
Just of the owners, the masters? Oh, off the top of my head, I don't know, but they're a relatively tiny minority compared to the whole population. Most Southerners were not slaveholders. Most Southern farmers, they are, how should I put it? their ambition was to become a slaveholder. So their whole culture is focused on, when can I earn enough money to buy some slaves? So that's, even when they're not slaveholders, and it's true, the majority of the farmers or the planters, small planters, had not yet had enough money. Their slaves were expensive. I think on the eve of the Civil War, some good field hands were going for $1,000, which would have been an enormous amount of money, going into the tens of thousands today, at least. So they're a tiny minority, the actual slaveholders, but they dominated the culture in a way that's hard for us to explain. They dominated economically because they were the patrons and the clients. The small farmer who's growing cotton, how does he yet sell his cotton to some merchant in Liverpool? He can't. He has no connections. So he has to go to the big planter who's acting as a kind of patron who either buys it outright or bundles the small farmer's cotton with his own bales and sends it off to London or Liverpool. So the small farmers are tied to these great planters, both psychologically, culturally, and I think economically. So the planters had dominated the world. And as I say, I think V. O'Keefe's book, and it's worth reading, because I think it still it still tells you a lot about the South prior to the opening up of the South. The South really, well, you know, you live in Florida, although Florida's not quite the same as a southern state. Like Alabama or Mississippi, or even Georgia or Virginia. But the extent to which the nature of the economy and slavery dominated the culture, I think, just can't be emphasized enough. And it affected the nature of the society and had profound effects even up into the 1930s. That's why I think Key's book is worth reading, that the South hadn't changed that much. And in fact, until the civil rights movement, the South was really had a kind of quasi-serfdom, slavery. Not slavery as such, but serfdom, sharecropping system. It really is only in the 20th century that the South has sort of become like the rest of the nation, become commercially involved in a different way. At least that's the point I'm trying to emphasize. Yes, way back. Go ahead.
I mentioned earlier. I said I met you earlier.
Oh, yes, of course.
So in the 1790s, when the planters were emancipating slaves at an unprecedented level,
yes,
it accompanied vagrancy laws that came from free blacks out of Virginia.
Yes.
So I'm wondering, in the concrete ideas that we have about how the founders were hoping for abolition, how the hundreds of thousands of freed slaves or freed blacks were going to fit into the new republic.
Okay. They weren't hundreds of thousands. They were more like tens of thousands that were being emancipated. And many people hadn't really thought through what to do with the slaves. I think in the North, they were able, because the percentages were small, they were able to adjust to a reasonably integrated society, because most of the slaves in the North were either household slaves or else artisans working under a white master. But in the South, when emancipation, when Jefferson faced, as he wrote in his Notes on Virginia, the problem of emancipation, his only solution was removal. Ethnic cleansing, I mean, we might call it, just remove all of the blacks from America. Either send them west, although that was not his favorite place because he wanted the white southern farmers to go west, to the Caribbean or to Africa. And thus was born the colonization movement, which, of course, Lincoln favored. Jefferson's argument is that the black slaves were a kind of separate nation. That justified our enslaving them because they had been captured, so to speak, in war, which is the justification for enslaving the victims of war. That's how the Greeks got their slaves. But since they were engaged in a war, we could never live as a biracial society. Jefferson is pessimistic on that point. He said, they will be our enemy forever, and they must be removed. He did not hold out the possibility of an integrated society. That, of course, was shared by many others, because it seemed as if the anger, he says, they will hate us till kingdom come. Black slaves, having been enslaved, would always hate whites. That's his, and so his solution was colonization. He had no other solution. In fact, Lincoln talked a great deal about it, but it was out of the question. You couldn't, you had 4 million, 5 million slaves by the time of the Civil War? There was just no possibility. And they were growing demographically as rapid as the whites. You couldn't remove them. Even if you sent 50,000, you know, a year, well, how long would that take to get rid of 5 million people who might be 10 million before you knew it? So it was just an impossible kind of situation. And we've come a long way, as you know. That's really the importance of Obama's election. I mean, it's a world historical event, given the background, given Jefferson's attitude, which is widely shared by others, that colonization was the only solution. We have come really a long way. Yes, sir, go ahead.
What do you see is the legacy of that period on the politics of the day?
Right. Well, it's just a different world back then. The states, the United States was always used in the plural up to the Civil War. The United States are. Diplomats, Daniel Webster, Secretary of State, talks about the United States are this. We were really thought of as 13, not 13, but kept growing, 20 states that are independent to some extent. So the notion of states' rights has much more validity prior to the Civil War. The Civil War was a massive nationalizing force, event. Not only did we become singular, the United States is, but we began nationalizing our currency, preventing the states from printing money, or banks in the states from printing currency. That was a nationalizing force that I think is overwhelming, has not been fully appreciated, just what it meant. You know, prior to the Civil War, the states, of course, are forbidden in the Constitution to print paper money. They got around that prohibition. They had to get around it. The economy would have been stifled. The founders had no idea how important money was, lots of money. They were frightened of it, and so they forbade the states from printing it. The federal government had no right, it seemed, to print money, or nobody was interested in having it print money again. So the states got around that by chartering banks, which in turn printed the money, but that money's flying all over the place. It made it very difficult for businesses to... I mean, what if you're a businessman in Georgia and you get a note drawn on a bank of Tennessee, one of the banks of Tennessee? There probably were 10 banks in Tennessee. What are you going to do? You're going to discount it? How's it going to... Well, that kind of problem. They had little guidebooks on what banks, how much to discount various banks depending on their reputation. Business was difficult to do. After the Civil War, there was a nationalizing. We printed greenbacks at the federal level. The states were forbidden. State banks were forbidden to pass notes, to print notes. The consequences of that alone in nationalizing the country. And, you know, today we don't think of the states as having the kind of independence. Maybe Southerners do, but generally speaking, the states are administrative units. We move around so much that it's hard to have the kind of loyalty that people had back then. People thought of the state as their country. Jefferson said, "My country," he meant Virginia. And you have to think of the original articles as very similar to the present-day EU. People in England or Germany or France, when they talk about my country, they don't think about this thing called the United States of Europe or the European Union. There are people trying to encourage that kind of thinking, but they're very weak. In the early United States, it was similar. That's why it was very difficult and always tentative. It was very important that Washington was the first president, because he stood for the Union. He was a kind of quasi-elected monarch. People's loyalty, affection, allegiance was to him because they had been reared in monarchy. So Washington, I think, held the nation together during that crucial first decade. But the states had much more power, much more support than they have today. There's a legacy, and we talk about states' rights. We still are something of a federal system. But in many respects, we're much more centralized than, say, Germany or Australia, which also are federal republics or federal states. Australia wants to be a republic but can't get up the gumption to break from Queen Elizabeth. But we have a stronger federal state. In other words, we have a more centralized system as a federal system than either of those two federal systems, Germany or Australia. Yes, sir. Yeah, they're in the red shirt, sure. And then come up here. No, go ahead. That's the next question.
Lincoln and his colleagues in the North obviously thought that they were precedent in the Revolutionary War for the federal crimes in the Civil War. Southern states also can claim
yes.
precedent for the Revolution and voted Jefferson and Locke on one.
No, you're quite right. The South looked back to the Revolution as well and appealed to their interpretation of the Revolution, which justified their secession. And of course, they appealed to the weak nature of the federal government that existed in 1776 and even in 1787, and tried to make a case that they had a right to secede and that the states were... And if you look at the Confederation, the Southern Confederation that's formed, it's a very weak central government. It sounds very similar. The Constitution is very similar to the previous Constitution, the U.S. Constitution, but it's got a stronger statement of states' rights. But it is still remarkably similar to the government that they just broke away from. But, of course, they're going to maintain slavery. What's one of the interesting things that about the, you know, Deep South goes out first. Virginia and the Upper South are still hesitating. Virginia's it's not as powerful as it was 50 years earlier, but it's still a very important state. The Lower South wants Virginia in the Confederation. So what do? They prohibit in the Constitution, Confederation Constitution, the importation, international importation of slaves. What does that mean? Virginia cannot export its slaves to the Deep South. There's enormous pressure put on Virginia. Nobody talks about that because it's kind of nasty thought, but they're under pressure because they have no market. Their only product on the eve of the Civil War is slaves. They're not selling anything else. And so to be prohibited to entering this market, this Deep South market, Alabama, Mississippi, Texas, Georgia, and so on, the South that went out first, was an incentive, let's put it that way. I don't think that's the reason why Virginia joined the Confederacy, but it certainly it must have had some kind of impact. Now, you had a question in front, yeah.
Yes, I'm sure you've seen the recent Steven Spielberg.
Yeah, Lincoln.
What do you think of the portrayal of some of President Lincoln's decisions, specifically delaying the peace talks with the South?
That's not true. I mean, it just never was viable. The story is, he's just screwed up the history a little bit. And I think even dramatically, if you've seen the picture, he should have stopped 10 minutes before he did. I mean, that idea of having that scene in the other theater where his boy Robert gets word of his father's being shot, and then didn't have to happen. All he had to do was end with that wonderful scene as Lincoln walks down the aisle in the White House towards, he's going out to the theater. That would have been the perfect ending. So dramatically, I think Spielberg is overrated myself. I mean, the portrayal of Lincoln by Daniel Day-Lewis, if you hadn't seen it, is just unbelievable. And he deserved that Academy Award. I mean, often Oscars are given to the wrong people for the wrong reasons. But in this case, I think he... And you, I don't know what Lincoln talked like. Day-Lewis apparently decided that he had a high kind of voice, and that may be true. There must be some reference to that, but that accounts for... And he was so much in the role, I've been told or read, that when he came on the set, he was President Lincoln to everyone else. They never talked to him as, you know, how you doing, Dan, or something. He was Mr. President, or he was President Lincoln. It was just an extraordinary performance. But I think that he fools around with the peace thing. There was nothing viable there at all. I mean, according to what historians, who are more expert than I, wrote. I mean, I think there are a couple of pieces in the New York Times, something in the New Republic that shows that Spielberg was playing fast and loose. I mean, also you realize he has an opening scene where the black slaves, or maybe they're black soldiers, begin reciting the Gettysburg Address to him as if they had memorized it. I mean, I just don't. Those are the kinds of touches that Spielberg, he's really a sentimentalist. He wants to pull your heartstrings. And I guess he's had some great movies, but I just thought that I think he's overrated myself. But the portrayal was wonderful of Lincoln. Any other questions? Yes, yes, sir.
I wonder, right before the Civil War, there was a kind of expansionism in slavery.
Right.
Kansas, Missouri Compromise, rumblings about annexation of Cuba.
Right.
And so forth. Was that because of this, every state has two senators, and therefore they'd be outnumbered eventually if all the new states out?
Well, that's true. They were worried about.
Thinking of dying in the South and kind of slavery moving west.
I think they had the feeling that slavery had to grow to live, and it had to expand. And if it can't expand westward, it can expand into Cuba. We came very close to taking Cuba. Jefferson wanted it desperately from his early days, and manipulated. It really was. We came very close at several times. We, of course, took Florida. Essentially, Jackson moved in, executed a couple of Brits who were here, and got away with it. It just was an extraordinary. And the Spanish really had such a weak hold that they just, in 1819, just decided we better just sell it or give it away, and we'll get some concessions from the Americans on trade and on debts and things. And so they gave us both Floridas, West and East Florida. But we were going to take it anyhow. You know, we had demographic imperialism. You can't imagine how fast growing we were. We were, as I say, the fertility rate was double that of the Europeans. So our population's growing. Jefferson just says, oh, it'll all fall to us like ripe fruit as our people just keep moving. And the growth rate was so strong that everyone assumed that we would just conquer not only Cuba, but probably Mexico as well with our population. I mean, some of them were dreaming about that. But the Spanish hold on Florida was so weak. They demographically, they knew they were done, and better to make this deal. It really came that close to getting Cuba. The Ostend Manifesto, you remember that from your high school, 1850s, where three diplomats in Europe set forth, I mean, three of our ambassadors in Britain, France, and Spain, I think, got together in Ostend in Belgium and issued a manifesto claiming Cuba for our, because it was a natural thing, it would fall to us like ripe fruit. Well, the president, was it Pierce at that time, had to repudiate it. It was just too embarrassing. And we never, and then, of course, the war came, and you're right. I don't think there was anything that could be done to stop it. People, you know, there was a whole interpretive generation of the 1930s, a revisionist history, it was called, which talked about the blundering generation of politicians, that they screwed up, they could have solved this problem. I don't think there was any solution. They tried with 1820, and the result of the Missouri Compromise, you had this line drawn across the United States. That fell apart, and then you had the compromises of 1850, which handled things for just a while. People were desperate. People like Clay and Webster didn't want this split. But it was coming, and I don't think there's anything anyone could have done. I don't see how it was a blundering part. The politicians, after 1820, there was nothing that could be done because the South was bent on maintaining slavery and expanding it, and the North, by that point, was bent on stopping the expansion. Lincoln, as you know, during the crisis, the immediate crisis, was willing to have a constitutional amendment passed preserving slavery in the existing states. We won't touch it. Again, based on this notion that slavery needed, he thought that this would kill off the institution eventually because it needed to expand. And from the Virginians' point of view, that's true. They needed to sell slaves. And maybe, you know, cotton grows well in Arizona. People think, there's some people who thought, well, it won't grow out there. But actually, Arizona and California produce quite a bit of cotton. So I just don't think there was anything that could be done to stop it. I don't see any blundering politicians. I mean, that's a big interpretive notion, and it's still got some. I mean, David Donnell, who is a relatively famous historian, at least in my years, always believed that somehow it was those demagogues who were inciting the people about slavery, and it could have been worked out. But I don't see any possibility. I mean, there was just no chance whatsoever.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
There are some reflections over here that we are under.